Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hey, listeners, it's Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. And for 2 years, we've brought you COVID-19 and public health news. But the podcast is just one of the ways you can learn more about the evidence and experts from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. If you like what we've been doing on the podcast, please consider subscribing to our e-newsletter, Expert Insights, which publishes on Tuesdays and Fridays. The newsletter contains the latest on how we're working to understand, manage, and eventually end the COVID-19 pandemic and prepare us for future outbreaks. We also cover the school's groundbreaking research and insights on climate change, mental health, racism, opioids, gun violence, and more. You can find our work at publichealth.jhu.edu/subscribe. That's publichealth.jhu.edu/subscribe. We so appreciate you being part of our public health community. Today, Dr. Caitlin Rivers returns to the podcast. Dr. Rivers is a senior scholar at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security, but she's been on leave to work as the associate director of the new Center for Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. She speaks to Dr. Josh Sharfstein about this brand new national effort. Let's listen.
Dr. Caitlin Rivers, it's great to have you back on Public Health On Call. You've been working for the CDC now for a few months, setting up this new Center for Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, it's good to be back. I think last time I was on the podcast, we were talking about the need for this kind of center. So it's exciting to be on the other side.
So let's refresh everyone's memory. Why did we need a Center for Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics?
Right. So we are very focused on modeling and analytics to support public health decision response. And I'll give you a few examples of what I mean by that, and then I'll tell you why we need it. So the kinds of questions that our center and our work would be able to answer are things like, what's the probability of a winter surge? What happens to the epidemic trajectory when we get vaccines for children under the age of 5? How worried should we be about this new outbreak that's in another country? Those are examples of questions that are actually informed by modeling and by outbreak analytics. And the appetite for these kinds of insights has really grown over the last years and decades, and there just hasn't been the infrastructure to be able to support answering these questions. And so that's what we are aiming to do.
Now, this effort was funded by Congress, is that right?
That's right. We received funding in the American Rescue Plan in March of last year.
And so that's when your phone rang and off you went to CDC.
We have a small leadership team. There's about 5 of us, and we started in August. So we've got a few months under our belt, but are still quite new.
So I know that there are a few academic centers that do forecasting. Every day there's a new model coming out from somewhere predicting something. How does this new effort relate to what was going on before?
All of those other activities will remain, but we have found that academics are very good at research. They're very good at being excellent partners to support public health practice, but we really need a capability within the federal government and within CDC to provide support to the incident command structure that's running the COVID response, to the director, to governors and state epidemiologists. The appetite for these products is huge. And so we are adding to the existing capability and really focusing on decision makers.
So in that regard, are you doing your own modeling, or is that all you're doing? Or are you also synthesizing, you know, from other places to kind of put information together in a usable way?
It will be a combination. We will have a large team of our own modelers. We haven't hired them yet because we're growing, but that's something we're working towards. And we will also have a set of activities devoted to research and development. So funding the existing academic modelers who will work to produce research during quote unquote peacetime and then be able to support a surge capacity when there is an emergency.
Is the primary audience of the Center for Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics decision makers? Will the public even know about anything that it does? How do you see the public side of this?
We have a roadmap that starts with decision makers because that is the network that we are already providing support to, but we definitely want to grow to support the public. I take a lot of inspiration from the National Weather Service, which provides weather forecasts and insights about storms and weather threats to the public. And it's so accurate and it's so ubiquitous that we don't even really notice that we are relying on models and analytics to make decisions about how we live our lives. And that's a place we want to grow to with our Center for Forecasting.
So in theory, just like I can type in, you know, NWS21205 and get the National Weather Service forecast for the School of Public Health, someday I may be able to type in maybe, I'm thinking of the letters here, CFOA21205 and I get the outbreak forecast.
The hope. And to some extent, you can already access some of that information on CDC's COVID tracker, but we see a big opportunity to grow that capability. So maybe it's not just COVID. Maybe in coming years, it'll be a wider variety of respiratory diseases. And we would like it to be linked to specific actions, recommended actions, like you might take an umbrella when it's raining. Maybe you grab a mask when there's a lot of disease activity in your area before you hop on the metro. And so that's the kind of ecosystem that we're working towards, but we're just getting started. And so it's room to grow.
So are you pretty seriously in stealth mode in the sense that you're just planning, or are there things that you've been able to do so far to help policymakers?
We are very focused on planning. There's a lot to stand up, a lot of administrative work. But when Omicron was first announced or came to the world's attention in November, we knew we couldn't sit it out because we foresaw that this could be really impactful to the United States. So we actually pivoted from planning to do a little bit of implementation. And we rallied our academic partners to put together models that showed what Omicron might look like when it became established in the United States. Saw that there was a big surge likely to come. And we turned around and briefed that to senior leaders within the government and also to the public. So there's actually a webpage that we drafted that is available to the public that describes the coming Omicron surge. There's one other thing we were able to do for Omicron that I want to share, which is something that we would like to make part of our regular operations. And that's what we're calling targeted studies, where we go out and collect the data to answer key questions. We did this with Omicron in partnership with Kaiser Permanente, where we actually compared the severity of Omicron to Delta in the Kaiser Permanente network. And so that answered a really important question about how we should think about the severity of Omicron.
Got it. Now, in that case, it's one population and, you know, it has its own distribution of prior exposure and vaccination. One of the challenges in assessing the severity of Omicron versus Delta was the different levels of immunity that people have before the virus hit. And it's still somewhat debated, as far as I can tell, just how big the difference is, because one question is whether we're just seeing Omicron to be more mild because so many people have been vaccinated by the time it showed up. How did that study help or add to the confusion? How do you see the role of the center? Is it just to do one study and just throw it in the mix? Or how do you pull that question together? And what in the end is your assessment of the severity of Omicron?
We were able to account for prior vaccination and prior infection in the study because Kaiser Permanente has a network where the outpatient care and the hospital care and the testing is all linked. And so you can follow people over time in that network in a way that's not possible for a lot of us who belong to care systems that don't span outpatient to inpatient in that way. But I think you're making a good point, which is that no single study can tell you the right answer for every population, for every circumstance. It's really about the pile of evidence or the weight of all of the evidence assembled. And so our study showed that Omicron is likely moderately less severe than Delta, but we're also drawing on information produced by our colleagues in the UK, Israel, other US estimates coming out to look at the totality of evidence.
Got it. Well, that's a really important function, synthesizing all of these different studies, because otherwise it's left to those of us reading scientific journals or newspaper articles or tweets, you know, where you just see one study said one thing, another study said another thing, and it's hard to really understand the big picture.
Yeah, there's definitely always a constellation of indicators that we have to look at and synthesize. And I think that's part of the value of our jobs as public health practitioners and communicators, is really helping the public to understand what do you need to know and what do you need to do differently with that information.
I have one more question for you, Dr. Rivers, and I don't know how to ask it other than to say, what could go wrong? What are you worried about in, you know, setting up a Center for Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics that, you know, might turn into a problem or backfire? What are you trying to avoid?
We are very focused on working closely with our data modernization initiative partners to make sure that our public health data ecosystem can support these kinds of activities. So first, I want to say that we have a long list of modeling and analytical products that we can produce using data we already have. It's not like we have to wait for some future state in order to be effective. And I think our work with Omicron shows that. But we also know that public health data in the United States is not where it needs to be. We need to grow, we need to evolve, we need to come into the modern era. And so we would like to take advantage of that modernization process, and we're helping to make sure that the implementation of it is successful.
What about the communications of some of these findings? You know, it's just been so fraught during the pandemic. How do you envision the center, you know, being able to communicate and communicate the uncertainty, like around its predictions, like we do for the weather? You know, it's a 70% chance of rain or something like that. You know, how will that work with your center?
This is something I'm really excited about. So we are devoting about one third of our operations to communications, which I think is a little bit different of a way people have thought about modeling and analytics before. It's not just turning the crank on the models. It's really making sure that people are able to receive and understand and implement those findings. And so about one third of our program will be devoted to communications. Now we see that the act or the personnel devoted to communications is important, and we're going to have a lot of capacity there. But I think there's also a research question in there, is how do people understand uncertainty and how can we better communicate what we see or what we're creating in the models? And so I think we also need to evolve the science of how we communicate our modeling findings.
Well, it's really great to hear how this effort's progressing, already having an impact, helping people appreciate Omicron, and growing so much from the point where, you know, as you said, you came on the podcast to say this is what the country needs, and here you are building it.
It's a thrill. Thanks for having me back on to talk about it.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinal, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.